Hi, my name is Massimo Ferri and this is our small team. I'm going to talk about non-topological persistence, not in the sense that we exclude topology, on the contrary, we include it as our most important particular case. I assume that here everybody knows what persistent topology and persistent homology are and how important they are for applications. How do they deal in applications with the persistence? They generally shape their data as a weighted simplicial complex and then perform a persistence on it. But how come is it so successful? In our opinion, it all depends on the particular shape of superimposed triangles that persistent Betti numbers functions have. This is what makes it possible to condense all relevant information into these points, which we call corner points, and out of them it's possible to apply distances, classifications, and all sorts of interesting analysis. But where does this particular shape come from? It's possible to prove that it just comes from two particular properties of persistent Betti number functions. Instead of reading them, I'll show them on this picture. The first property is that persistent Betti number functions are non-decreasing in horizontal, non-increasing in vertical. The second one concerns vertical and horizontal rectangles and looks at the difference of the values of the function on the lower edge, which turns out to be greater than or equal to the difference of the values on the upper edge. Here, for instance, we have 2 minus 2 equal to 2 minus 2. Here, 3 minus 2 equal to 2 minus 1. And here we have the interesting case, the one of strict inequality, 3 minus 2 greater than 2, 2 minus 2. And this also reveals the existence inside of this square of a corner point and makes it also possible to define a multiplicity for it. Now to graphs. A graph, of course, can be considered a one-dimensional CW complex. If we have a filtering function on its edges, it's possible to extend it to the whole complex. So we can do normal classical persistence on it, persistent homology, and for instance, for this weighted graph, we get this 0-degree persistent Betti number function, this 1-degree persistent Betti number function, which reveals quite a lot, of course, on the evolution of the simplicial structure through the filtration. But in applications, they generally are interested in other structures, more of graph theoretical type, for instance, cliques, clique communities, neighborhoods. These are structures which have the hereditary property which makes them potential simplices in a simplicial complex. But what if we are interested in structures which do not have that particular hereditary property? In a very general class of categories, it's possible to give a generalization to those functions, but I'll stick just to two graphs. A persistence function is defined as a function as a correspondence which maps each pair of real numbers u less than or equal to v to an integer for in such a way that those two properties hold. They were the properties which can be proved for persistent Betti number functions, but here they become part of the definition itself of these functions. So it's possible to have out of them persistence diagrams, and so to have bottleneck, Wasserstein distances, stability, classification, retrieval, all sorts of things that we generally do with normal persistence. Let me give an example. First, let me recall what a block in a graph is. It is a subgraph of the given graph, which contains no cut vertex and which is maximal with respect to this property. Please note that a subset of a block is generally not a block, so it can't be a potential simplex in a simplicial complex. But we can still define the persistent block number function as this function which maps the pair uv to the number of blocks of the subgraph g sub v containing at least one block of the subgraph g sub u. This mimics the what we have in zero degree persistent Betti numbers. There we take the number of path connected components of the sublevel set under V containing at least one path connected component of the sublevel set under U. Well, it's possible to show that this function has those two properties, so is a persistence function. And the same thing if you are interested in edge blocks, we can build a persistent edge block number function, which is also a persistence function. If we take the same weighted graph as before, we see a quite different picture, of course, because now we are interested in the evolution of blocks through the filtration. And again, a different picture if we are interested in the evolution of edge blocks. Okay, but we have a very general machinery for building persistence functions. This is called steady and ranging sets and can be defined for very many features in a graph, for instance, but not only, but I'll stick just to one, hubs. Generally in a graph, a hub is defined as a vertex whose degree is greater than or equal to the degree of its neighbors. But we use this as a temporary definition in the sense that this a vertex is called a temporary hub or T-hub at level U if it is a vertex of G sub U, the subgraph under U, whose degree is greater than or equal to the degree of its neighbors in that particular subgraph. A steady hub or S-hub at UV is a vertex which is a T-hub at all levels W with U less than or equal to W less than V. A ranging hub or R-hub at UV is a vertex such that there exist levels W under U and W prime above V at which it is a T-hub. And so we can define these two functions, sigma GF, which counts the number of S hubs at UV, which is a persistence function, and rho GF, which counts the number of R hubs at UV, and which is a persistence function too. A first example, a first application we did is with major North American airports as vertices, edges connecting airports between which there are regular flights. Filtering functions, distance, weekly flight frequency, the product of the two, the opposites of the three. These are the airports, well, the cities we consider. If we had more than one airport, we merged them into a single vertex. And here we also have the degrees in this graph. Well, generally, one would simply consider relevant hubs, the ones with the highest degrees. In our case, they would be Atlanta with degree 42, Dallas with degree 41, Chicago and Houston with degree 40. And actually, they often occur in our analysis, but not always. And being relevant here means giving rise to relevant corner points in our persistence diagrams. But how do we decide whether a corner point is relevant or not? It is by a very nice trick by Vitaly Kurlin, which is the widest diagonal gap, which is the widest empty diagonal strip among corner points. In this case, with filtering function distance and steady hubs, we have that above the widest diagonal gap, we have two corner points representing Atlanta, one representing Dallas, but also one representing Seattle, which is just 12th in the ranking with degree 34. And even if we take the opposite, actually maximum distance minus distance, and again steady hubs, we have that all the vertices with the highest degree give rise to corner points which are below the under the widest diagonal gap, and above we find Los Angeles, San Francisco, and Seattle, which are between the 7th and the 12th position in our ranking given by degrees. A second application is with the languages of the European Union plus Turkish, as vertices, complete graph, filtering function, the opposite of the percentage or common properties found in this very interesting site. We get various persistence diagrams. One is this with ranging hubs, and we find in this case just six corner points. The lower ones are Swedish, Castilian, Catalan, and Dutch, and above the widest diagonal gap we find English and Portuguese. We do not claim that this has a particular meaning. We just have wanted to perform some first experiments, and the message you could take home is it is possible to do persistence also without simplicial complexes. Thank you.